with us today. Okay, from the point of view of his curriculum, he has an incredible curriculum because Giorgio Maestroni graduated at the University of Milan in started from biological studies, and then he became researcher, first of all, at the Italian Institute of Hydrobiology in Verbania, but then he decided to move in 1965 to the Schweizerisches Forschungsinstitut in Davos, in Switzerland, where he began his studies in the neural regulation of the immune system. And after 1 year, he went to the Weizmann Institute for Science in Rehovot in Israel, where he continued for a stage in experimental oncology. When he moved to Zurich, where he studied the immunological consequences of allogeneic bone marrow transplantation and collaborated also with the Nobel Prize for Medicine or Physiology, Rolf Zinkernagel, that probably most of you know for what he did in the immunological field. And then in 1981, he moved to the Cantonal Institute of Pathology, Locarno, Switzerland, where he set up and directed the laboratory for experimental pathology until 2008. And in this laboratory, he gave a lot of contributions to neuroimmunology, to psychoneuroendocrine immunology, working on a lot of systems. For instance, he gave seminal contribution to the understanding of the role of melatonin and of circadian rhythms in the human body. And it is here that we, Franca Marino and me, had the opportunity, the honor, and the great luck to meet Giorgio Maestroni, and I'm absolutely pleased to introduce him here because he's not only a very good friend of us, but for me, he was teacher in the field of neuroimmunology, and I'm absolutely convinced that if now here in Varese we are trying to do something in this field, it's absolutely his merit or maybe his fault, I don't know. We will see. So thank you very much, Giorgio, and please give us your talk.
Thank you, Marco, for the nice, very nice talk. I would like to start the speech. With a provocative question, somewhat, because I will tell later why this question arose. Yes, okay. So the question is that one. Can't immunology see the forest for the trees? Why I'm saying that? When I started studying the neural connection, I mean the neural connection of the immune system, the bidirectional connection, it was barely the difference between lymph T and B lymphocytes was barely known. It was in the 1960s that the role of thymus was described for the first time by Miller, that got even the Nobel Prize for that. But nobody knew all the various subpopulations of immunocompetent cells with the various marker cluster of differentiation, the ability of secrete various cytokines, and the different function of all these subpopulations, and the effector function, I mean the differentiative pathway and the effector function. This is an enormous amount of data built in these years that goes together with the information about the anatomy of the immune system. I mentioned just that it was just known for a few years that was known that the thymus was a primary lymphoid organs. The other primary lymphoid organs is the bone marrow, and of course all the lymph nodes and the secondary lymphoid organs and the gut-associated lymphoid tissue, the skin-associated lymphoid tissue. And now it is known that the lymphocytes and immunocompetent cells do circulate among all these organs, going from the interstitial space in the tissues into the lymph, and then passing through the secondary lymphoid organs, draining the secondary lymphoid organs for going again into the blood and starting again the cycle. And also, it is not many years that the danger signals for the immune system are known. For example, the PAMs are the pathogen-associated molecular patterns are sensed by a receptor, specific receptor. Here we have the toll-like receptor family. It is known not only the molecular structure of each one, but is known also the agonist, the various agonists coming from the various microbial pathogen, either bacteria or viruses. And it is known a little bit, not completely, but most of the secondary messengers that goes to the nucleus and translate the message into the in protein synthesis, namely inflammatory cytokine production. It is known today the kinetic of the how an immune response is mounted, starting from the professional antigen presenting cells that are the dendritic cells that are sitting in the periphery in the various organs in immature states. And when they get the signal from an antigen, from a danger signal, they start maturing and migrating to the efferent lymphatic vessel, to the draining lymph node, and express the antigens, part of the antigen that is degraded and re-expressed within the cells in association with MHC class 1 and class 2 molecules. And then this, after migration, they meet in the lymph node B and T cells, and they may mount, instruct a specific immune response, either humoral with the production of specific antibodies, or cellular with the generation of cytotoxic T lymphocytes. And this would result either in the immune response itself, the proper immune response that is effective against the danger, the infectious agents, or it may also result in certain situation in a tolerance outcome. These immunocompetent cells, they communicate each other, but not only each other, but by the family of the cytokines. Cytokines are glycoprotein of around of the is a cytokine production and with a pattern of cytokine receptors, and is communicating with other immunocompetent cells. And these cytokines, we have learned this morning that may communicate also with other organs, namely the central nervous system, we will see later. Besides the cytokines, there are the whole big family of chemokines with their receptors. These chemokines are the smaller molecule than cytokines, but similar molecules that provide the messenger system, especially playing the role for chemotaxis and circulation of various immunocompetent cells. And then there is all the big field of the secondary messenger pathway that each receptor, antibodies and so forth, they may translate to the nucleus for the proper protein production. Okay, all this enormous amount of data are published, of course, in immunology journals. I did a quick survey in this type of survey in a Shimago journal and country rank, and the subject category was, of course, immunology, and the year was the last year, 2010. The journal was 190. They published in 1 year 58,442 articles. And these articles, they were citing over 2 million references. And this amount, in spite of this amount enormous amount of data, amazingly we are unable to, first, to potentiate specific immunological arms during the immune response to viral and bacterial infection. If you have a patient with an infection, we are not able to modulate the immune response in order that the patient will get better. We are just able to give anti-inflammatory agents or antibiotics, but not to go in details into the response against the infectious agent and modulate it. We are unable to induce a long-lasting T-cell memory. For example, we are still unable to build a malaria vaccine because we cannot induce a long-lasting T-cell memory. We are unable to prevent or cure autoimmune and allergic diseases. We are just intervening pharmacologically to alleviate the symptoms. And in the last years, maybe we can intervene with anti-cytokines, antibodies, but even less we are able to prevent this type of disease because we don't know really what is going on into the immune system when it starts this type of disease. We are unable to induce organ-specific tolerance. Again, we are intervening very roughly by giving various drugs, general immunosuppressive drugs that don't distinguish between the various cell subtypes that are that can mount an organ transplantation or even induce an organ tolerance. And finally, we are unable to instruct the immune system to destroy cancer cells. There is a lot of evidence that the immune system is important to maintain to destroy cancer cells physiologically that arise from mutation and so on, but we are not, there are efforts, and tomorrow we will see our studies in this direction to build cancer vaccines. But if in the animals setting the results are quite reasonable, in the clinical level are not so so good. So the answer to the question was is probably yes, immunology can see the forest for the trees. And the next question is the study of the neural and endocrine effects on the immune system able to overcome the problem? I think nobody can claim yet it. There is no doubt, and we learned this morning and probably even yesterday that I was not present, that there is wide evidence about the presence of functional crosstalk between the neuroendocrine and the immune system. In 2004, I wrote a letter to Natural Immunology because all this, there is I apologize for the writing that is not space, there is not space, but I think there is a problem with the Macintosh and PC compatibility. There is still a reluctance by the immunology journals to accept the publication in this field, in the field of the neuro, because the immunology, the classical immunological point of view is that the immune system is an autonomous system, and if you take what you can observe in vitro is true for also in vivo, the in vivo behavior of the cells. That obviously is not true. And I wrote this letter just to pointing out this dichotomy, this reluctance to publish this type of approach, because in my opinion and also of many other colleagues, this situation is perpetuating a cultural separation that is detrimental for the advancement of immunology. As a matter of fact, the immune system reacts, the neuroendocrine connection with the immune system react to pathogens or to infectious agents, the very same reaction of stress event. The stress event is perceived by the central nervous system, and then it stimulates the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis with the release of adrenocorticotropic hormone and the release of glucocorticoid that goes to the various organs as in the adaptive response to stress. The very same is triggered by cytokines after an inflammatory stimulus, an infectious agent that is stimulating the toll-like receptor. Cytokines goes to the central nervous system and trigger the very same mechanism of the HPA axis with the final release of glucocorticoids that goes to the immune system with mainly a depressive function. Then there is other the autonomous nervous system that we will see in a few moments. The fact that the central nervous system is playing an important role for the maintenance of the good shape of the immune reactivity, or and maybe even the contrary is true, is provided by this observation that if you have an injury of the central nervous system, you have 99% of the times an immunodeficiency syndrome. If you have other type of trauma like hemorrhage or major surgery, even in these cases, you have an immunodeficiency syndrome, and this immunodeficiency syndrome is complicating the picture, because the most of these patients that are after a major trauma, they are at the risk for infections. Of course, the central nervous system may communicate with the immune system via many different mechanisms. We saw the adrenal glands, but even the gonads and the sex hormones, they influence the immunity because, for example, speaking about autoimmune diseases, it is known the sex difference in the incidence of autoimmune diseases that are more frequent in women than in men. The thyroid hormones of course, are affecting each cells. And then there is the autonomous nervous system with the sympathetic fibers, the parasympathetic fibers, and also the neuropeptides, substance P and the endogenous opioids, endogenous cannabinoids, that are not peptide, but anyhow are these neurotransmitters that may influence the immune system. There is the evidence, there is also the presence of a so-called vagal anti-inflammatory reflex. If you have an injury, an infection, an ischemia, is activating phagocytes, and the phagocytes release cytokines like TNF or IL-1, and these are detected by the sensory vagus that goes to the nucleus tractus solitarius, and the response is the release through the motor vagus. There is acetylcholine that is binding to nicotinic receptor on the phagocyte, suppressing the release of inflammatory cytokines. There is also the sympathetic effect on the immunocompetent cells, and we will see the sympathetic nervous system is innervating all the organs by postganglionic fibers. And here in this list, you see the spleen, but not only the spleen, but all the lymphoid organs, including the bone marrow, the thymus, and the lymph node are innervated by sympathetic fibers. And this sympathetic fiber ends in proximity of the immunocompetent cells within the lymphoid organ with varicosities that are releasing mainly norepinephrine, but also neuropeptide and dopamine in certain cases. And here you can see there is an effect on the various subpopulation. Mainly here is shown mainly a negative effect, that the, a negative effect on Th1 is favoring via the complex communication of interconnection with the cytokines, is favoring the Th2 differentiation, and so on and so forth. The neurotransmitters, the catecholamines, especially norepinephrine, act on adrenergic receptors. We have nine genes, three alpha 1 A, B, and D, three alpha 2 A, B, and C, and three beta adrenergic receptors. So the sympathetic nerve fibers release norepinephrine, which act on receptors on the immunocompetent cells. In this case, this is depicted the CD4 lymphocytes, either naive states or either at the differentiated state. And the effect is different according to the state of differentiation. On top of this, there is this very interesting field of research started by Marco Cosentino and his collaborators, that lymphocytes themselves may release, synthesize and release catecholamines, which may act in an autocrine manner on the lymphocytes themselves that produce the catecholamines, or in a paracrine fashion on other target cells, for example, neurons, glial cells, blood vessels, and other immune cells like dendritic cells that are the so-called professional antigen-presenting cells. And the, as I was saying before, according to the type of target, the response to norepinephrine may be different. For example, naive T cells may differentiate to Th1, and if they are exposed to norepinephrine after differentiation, they will produce more interferon gamma than in a case they will not be exposed to the catecholamine. Th2 cells do not respond to catecholamine because apparently they don't express adrenergic receptor. And also the timing of exposure to norepinephrine seems to be important. For example, if Th1 cells are exposed to norepinephrine after before the cell receptor stimulation, the response will be a decrease of interferon gamma production. If it is added at the time of TCR stimulation, there is no effect. It is added 12 hours after TCR stimulation, there is an effect, the opposite effect, an increase of interferon gamma production. Concerning B cells, beta 2 adrenergic receptor activated by norepinephrine or by an agonist stimulate the expression of a co-stimulatory molecule CD86, and this will turn out to result in an increased production of IgG1, for example. Then there are other type of evidences. Tomorrow we will see this part of the world, and that adrenergic agonists, they may also, especially beta 2 adrenergic agonists, may also be involved in IL-17 production, modulate IL-17 production. Now I would like to briefly review one of the main main interest in this field, that I was busy for years in this field, because melatonin is known that when I started working in this field, was known as a molecule that was shaping or giving the time, the right timing for seasonally reproducing animals for the right time for reproduction.
Melatonin is deriving from serotonin mainly from two enzymatic step. N-acetyltransferase is transforming serotonin to N-acetyl serotonin, and then the second hydroxyorthomethyltransferase is transforming N-acetyl serotonin into melatonin, that is N-acetyl-5-methoxyserotonin, the chemical name. Melatonin that is circulating into the blood is mainly produced by the pineal gland that is sitting on the posterior wall of the third ventricle. And the name is deriving from the fact that its shape is that of a pine cone. The main basic function of melatonin is to synchronize the photoperiod in the organism. In other words, the organism knows that is night or day because melatonin is released or not. How it happens? Light is detected in the front part of the retina where there are neuronal cells different from the rod and cones that serve the visions. But these neuronal cells, they have the photopigment melanopsin that is different from the classical opsin. And this give rise to the signal that goes in a parallel way to the retinohypothalamic tract and goes to the pineal gland after doing a long way down to the spinal cord and then up again through the superior cervical ganglion and innervating the pineal gland with a postganglionic sympathetic neurons. Therefore, the release at the end of the nerve ending is what is released is norepinephrine that is acting on alpha and beta adrenergic receptor and stimulating the two enzymes we saw before that convert serotonin to melatonin. Okay, in presence of light, this at the level of the pineal gland, there is no release, very little release of norepinephrine, so there is no synthesis of melatonin. And on the contrary, in the absence of light, at the level of pineal gland, norepinephrine is released and melatonin synthesis starts and is immediately released in the circulation. So the consequence is that in each animal that has been studied so far, there is the presence of a circadian rhythm of melatonin. You have melatonin secreted during the night and not during the day. And as a further consequence is that during the season, for example, here you have the winter pattern of melatonin secretion. It changes also during the season. Here you have long day, long night, and short days. And here you have in summer a short night and long days. So in certain animals, like ungulates, for example, is the transition between the summer pattern of secretion to the winter pattern of secretion in autumn that gives the signal, the endocrine signal for reproduction. In other animals, is the opposite, is the transition from the winter pattern to the summer pattern in spring that gives, in rodent, for example, give the same signal. Of course, this is the timing is optimized to is so that is optimizing the chance of survival of the offspring. In humans, there are the presence of a clear melatonin rhythm is known since many years. Here you have three individuals with melatonin and its main metabolite that is 6-sulfate melatonin. And one of the interesting observation about the physiological variation relation with other physiological parameters. If you have here the body temperature, you see that is in opposite in a negative correlation with the peak of melatonin. Another physiological parameter affecting melatonin is age. Newborn have little melatonin, then the highest amount is in infancy, and then is decreasing to an adult level. to further decrease with aging, with senescence. If you treat, these are slide represent the effect of atenolol, a beta blocker given to 6 individuals. The day before they were given a placebo, I mean no drug. And the following night they were given atenolol per os. And you see atenolol flattened completely the curve of melatonin because it's blocking the beta adrenergic receptor in the pineal, and the noradrenaline cannot trigger the synthesis of melatonin. You see here just melatonin in the immune system in before 1985, there was no publication. We started in 1986, and then there was this evolution that is nothing in comparison with the enormous amount of information in immunological journal. Just to see, this is just, of course, even this is a specific field, this is a specific study, but I mean, if you combine all the study in the psychoneuroimmunology or neuroimmunomodulation, what as you like it to define this field, you will find that there is an enormous, much more or less information that in the field of hard, so-called hard immunology. What we found at the beginning has been published here in these journals. This basically was the following. Here we, at that time, it was very fashion. I mean, we could measure antibody production by this plaque-forming cell per spleen. What it is, we injected mice, group of mice with the Shibret cells. And then after 4 days, we took the spleen and making a cell suspension. And mixing the cell suspension, counting them, of course, and mixing a certain number of spleen cells with Shibret cells that were injected, the same type of that were injected before, and in agar, and then plating the mixture in petri dishes and covering the dish with a guinea pig complement. And this would then incubate overnight, and this the presence of complement with the antibody produced by the plasma cells, they were generating lysis plaque of lysis that were counted as a plaque-forming cells. Each plasma cells generated a lysis hole in the layer of agar and Shibret cells. And so this was a way of measuring the immune response in vivo. And we injected the mice and we with saline with this very small amount of melatonin in the afternoon, and we got that already at 10 microgram per kilogram body weight of melatonin, we got a significant increase of plaque-forming cells. When we augmented the dose to very huge dose, the effect was the opposite. The effect was of melatonin was evident only if melatonin was injected in the evening in a way consonant with its endogenous rhythm. If melatonin, the same dose of melatonin was injected in the morning, it was not effective. And this was then later explained by the fact that not only melatonin is secreted, because melatonin is secreted in a circadian fashion during the night, it downregulates its own hormone, its own receptors, and in the morning, the receptors are very not expressed or very low expression of these receptors. And then with the absence of melatonin, the receptors start to be expressed again, and this is because then melatonin may act on the, may exert its function. This, another an amazing, surprising ability of melatonin to counteract the effect of stress. In mice that were injected with Shibret cells, here you see the effect of stress were no. Non si può andare indietro? Okay. Vado avanti. Ancora una volta. No, vabbè. Sì, qui è successo qualcosa. Vabbè, avanti. Ok. Melatonin disabled to counteract the effect of isolation stress. This year measured as a ratio between thymus weight and body weight. If you take an animal and you isolate it in a cage, restraining a little bit its movement, is becoming anxious and distressed, and at the end, by the release of corticosteroid, you will find an atrophy or decrease of thymus weight, because corticosteroid, of course, they exert this action at the level of thymus. And here you see the effect of melatonin was able to counteract the effect of stress, that is that one only in mice that are were stimulated with an antigen, but not with in mice that were not stimulated. Here you see the C group, given only melatonin, stress and melatonin, the ratio between thymus weight and body weight was low, like the one shown by saline-treated and stressed mice. And while melatonin in mice that were injected with an antigen brought the ratio between thymus weight and body weight to the level of non-stressed mice. A similar effect was seen in a more dramatic, rough model. This mice were injected with West Nile virus that in normal mice is not giving any mortality. While isolation stress or dexamethasone treatment produced a 75 or 55% mortality. Melatonin given after isolation stress or after dexamethasone treatment brought the mortality to 31 and 25% respectively. In a series of studies, this is just examples, of course, but the series of studies performed by Paolo Lissoni in Monza, at that time it was an approach to cure very advanced cancer was to give IL-2 to stimulate cytotoxic T cells to fight against cancer cells. And here, this study was melatonin was added to IL-2 and it resulted in an improved survival of terminal patients of about 4 months. In experimental oncology, here you see we choose a model in which mice were injected with Lewis lung carcinoma. It's a tumor that, if injected intramuscularly, is growing at the site of injection, but it is giving also spontaneous metastasis at the lung level, into the lungs. Here we take a different group of animals, and we measured the leukocyte per microliter in the blood, the platelet, and the concentration of granulocyte macrophage precursor into the femur in the hematopoietic compartment. The mice were either controlled, not injected with any tumor, or mice that were transplanted with the tumor and treated with saline, and mice that were treated with melatonin, and mice that were treated with cyclophosphamide. You see, cyclophosphamide is a cytotoxic drug still used in the clinical level, is giving a reduction, depressing leukocyte counts, platelet counts, and also the number, the counts of myeloid precursor into the femur, into the bone marrow, but virtually cured the tumor. No primary tumor was found and no metastasis. Giving melatonin together with cyclophosphamide, we were able to counteract almost completely the hematopoietic toxicity of cyclophosphamide without anyhow affecting its anti-cancer action. Okay, this has been, this type of evidence has been also reproduced in humans. And but of course, melatonin is a big problem to be a natural substance and cannot be protected by any patent, commercial patent. So, and also it has been object of very silly books in the past, claiming that the substance melatonin, it was a kind of panacea, able to healing almost everything. And this gave a very bad reputation to melatonin research as a whole. Melatonin anyhow is acting as a real hormone because it's acting at the level of specific receptor, very high affinity receptor, you see here, MT1, MT2. MT3 seems not to be present, seems to be present only in birds, but not in mammals. And the receptor is a picomolar range of affinity. Even the melatonin immune system paper are not so much, but still they are there. The connection that are described in literature between the ability of melatonin to modulate the various immunocompetent cells and the cytokine production is depicted here in this slide that I do not pretend that you go to enter into details. And here is also depicted the effect of possible effect of showed the possible effect of melatonin in hematopoiesis. Here we come to a more recent study done in collaboration with Professor Cutolo in Genoa. We were in a previous studies we observed that patients with rheumatoid arthritis do show an highest production, highest peak of melatonin in the plasma during the night in comparison to age-matched healthy control. As it is known that in the, especially rheumatoid arthritis, but also other autoimmune diseases, the incidence and the severity of this rheumatoid arthritis in particular show a north-south gradient, with the northern countries being more affected and even the patients showing more severe symptoms. We wanted to see whether how it was the melatonin situation in the Estonia rheumatoid arthritis patients. And you can see here also in Estonia patients show the highest melatonin production than age-matched healthy control. For the other parameter measured, cortisol and IL-6, there was no difference, a little bit, of course, obvious difference in TN, tumor necrosis factor concentration. But what it was surprising that when we compared the Estonia patient with the Italian patients, we got the results that with the finding that the Estonia patients were producing more melatonin than the Italian patients, and no significant difference was found for the other parameters. And this suggested that melatonin in this type of autoimmune disease, due to its ability to stimulate immunocompetent cells, is maybe a player promoting action on this case. In fact, we found the presence of specific binding site of melatonin in synovial macrophage taken from rheumatoid arthritis patients. And as melatonin is known to stimulate inflammatory cytokine production, it might be that the reason why there is this correlation. Another field in which melatonin has been widely studied is sleep. You see here, this melatonin trial. You see the yellow-orange part of the picture is meaning that the sleep efficiency is higher in this setting in comparison to placebo. So melatonin is known to exert an hypnotic-like effect, not a real hypnotic, but is favoring the structure and increasing the sleep efficiency. And on the other end, sleep is I apologize again for this, but I think we can manage to read in any case. Sleep seems to have a very vital role in the immune system. In fact, sleep deprivation has a dramatic effect on the immune response and increasing morbidity and mortality. And finally, sleep might be considered a vital part of the immune system. And melatonin may exert its effect on the immune system, not only acting on the various direct effect on melatonin receptor immunocompetent cells and release of cytokines, that on the other end, these same cytokines like interleukin-1 especially, but even other type of cytokines like tumor-necrosis factor are involved in the normal sleep-wake cycle. So just a suggestion that melatonin may act by either directly on immunocompetent cells or via its ability to entrain the circadian rhythm, including the sleep-wake cycles. Again, in analogy with catecholamines, melatonin may be produced even in immunocompetent cells, human lymphocytes. Here is one Guerrero group in Sevilla showed this connection, these studies published in this journal. Here you see the presence of melatonin, and melatonin production is augmented if cells are stimulated. And the pathway synthesis pathway seem to be the very same of that present in the pineal gland, because with antisense against the NSAID transferase is diminishing the production of melatonin. On the other, and also parachlorophenylalanine here abolish the secretion of the production of melatonin because is an inhibitor for the synthesis of serotonin. So the lack of precursor, it is the lack of the melatonin. It means that melatonin is deriving even in these cells from serotonin. Here you see when the cells are stimulated in presence of parachlorophenylalanine or in absence, there is no less production of melatonin. Melatonin production by the human lymphocytes is also correlated well with the expression of CD25, that is the receptor for IL-2. CD3 is the marker for T cells. And you see here again, melatonin is increasing a little bit the expression of CD25, and again, PCPA is inhibiting it, and the addition of melatonin is almost restoring the effect on CD25. And this effect is exerted probably at the level of membrane and nuclear receptor, because Luzindol here is an antagonist for membrane receptor, while this CGP55644 is acting on retinoid orphan receptor at the level of nucleus, and this is believed to be another site in which melatonin may exert its function at the nuclear level. And here you see the conclusion of these studies, that melatonin is released when the cells are activated. It may act on the membrane receptor, MT1 or MT2, increasing the production of IL-2 and also of its receptor, and And Luzindol is inhibiting this loop. And also melatonin may be secreted and have a paracrine effect on the other cell types. One of the last publication of this group of Juan Guerrero, Spanish group here, showed that the retinoid orphan receptors through the action of melatonin is degraded more quickly than normally. And this retinoid receptor is the degradation of this type of nuclear receptor is associated with an increased IL-2 production. When instead of we degraded, these are activated. Instead of IL-2, it will be produced IL-17 with the consequence polarization of T helper cells at the TH17 cells. While if IL-2 is produced, it might be the counterpart of TH17 cells that are the T regulatory cells that may be, there are on the other end other evidence that melatonin may increase the production of T regulatory cells that are so important for the regulation, the homeostasis of the immune response. So melatonin may act either secreted by the pineal gland or by the lymphocytes themselves, may act on the lymphocytes. And the effect that has been described, it is increased T cell proliferation, increased TH1 cytokines, increased NK activity, decreased BNT cell apoptosis, modulation of hematopoiesis. And this may have an immune-enhancing effect and be possibly exploited in viral diseases and cancer immunotherapy. And possible promotion, while it may have also an adverse effect, because it may promote T lymphomas, and we got we published a paper showing in a mice murine model that it seems to be the case, and may also, because of its possible link with in rheumatoid arthritis, may have a promoting effect in autoimmune disease. The future research about melatonin could be to assess its possible therapeutic use in controlled clinical studies, for example, viral and bacterial infection, septic shock. There is evidence that melatonin is effective in experimental model of septic shock, secondary immunodeficiency, cancer immunotherapy, autoimmune disease, and so on, with, of course, antagonists. And there are further questions at basic level that are still not clear, if whether melatonin effect is different according to the subpopulation involved, whether the season is affecting the melatonin action. What are the immunological correlate of the melatonin effect on sleep? What is the physiological role of circulating pineal, deriving from the pineal gland, versus endogenous melatonin in the immune system, and so on? The last question is for you, as a young researcher. You should hopefully answer to this question. If we adding all these details about the neuroimmune interaction, we are just contributing to hide the forest. Thank you for the attention.